Birmingham, 1972, home of the Mini, Black Sabbath and Cadbury's Chocolate, the youngest city in Europe with more canals than Venice, has always been a thriving hub for industry and artists alike. Yes, the nation's second city was not only known for its transport links and industrial prowess, it was fast becoming a multicultural haven for artists and musicians to learn and share their craft. Perhaps in response to this, the ever-changing city signed up to the 1972 Out There City Sculptures project, a decision that some in the council would soon come to regret.
Lord Nelson's column should be there. Lord Nelson's statue. Somebody stand up for it. What is nothing. What does that represent? What does it represent? Nothing.
Do you think it's a waste of money then?
I certainly do, yes. I hope Birmingham don't buy it.
Well, what made you decide on King Kong for a place like Birmingham?
Well, the work was meant to be city orientated, was the way it was described, and that immediately made me think of King Kong.
Well, how do you think King Kong is city orientated?
Well, as when you think of King Kong, you think of New York, and I haven't really compared Birmingham with New York until I came in on the train this morning, actually. It did look quite like New York, I believe.
That was Nicholas Monroe, renowned English pop art sculptor, printmaker, and art teacher. He is famed for being one of the few British pop artists to work with sculpture and is known for his work with fiberglass. Monroe built the statue out of his studio in Hungerford, Berkshire, and despite having never actually seen the 1933 motion picture, he decided that it would be the perfect response to the Artwork for Public Places scheme in 1972. The scheme allowed cities like Birmingham to display the artwork for 6 months before being given the chance to buy it and keep it permanently. Ultimately, none of the artwork associated with the scheme were purchased by their respective cities. After just 2 months of the statue welcoming travellers from Birmingham's New Street station, over 100 people had signed a petition calling for Kong to be removed. Birmingham rejected Monroe's masterpiece, with the council claiming to them it was not worth 2,000 pennies or £2,000. One person who could see the value of Kong, however, was this man, Michael Shanley. Michael Shanley purchased the statue in September 1972, just 4 months after Kong had initially arrived in Birmingham. He intended to capitalise on the buzz around Kong's departure to drive more people to his used car dealership, the King Kong Car Company, later known as the Second City Motor Company.
Now he's been demoted to selling second-hand cars. It's a long way from a screen idol to a second-hand car salesman. The man who bought King Kong is Mr. Mike Shanley. Mike, why have you bought King Kong?
I think he'll be a good publicity agent for me, and he'll bring more customers here.
You've paid almost £3,000. Do you think it's a good buy for the money?
I think so. I'm sure he'll bring people here. You've only got to look at the cars and buses going past.
And bring people he did. Kong stayed with Michael for 4 years, and in that time, Shanley did an excellent job at utilising the giant gorilla for any occasion. Many of those who were too young to remember Kong in the Manzoni Gardens recall fond memories of searching from the top deck of the number 37 bus as it crossed the flyover between Camp Hill and Digbeth. After just 4 years in Birmingham, Scottish businessman Nigel Mabey purchased the statue for £12,700. Kong travelled over 300 miles to a large auction site next to Edinburgh Airport, where he would stay for almost 30 years. During that time, he was repainted white, tartan and pink, becoming a landmark meeting point for families and friends that visited the Skersgill markets. After After Nigel passed away in 2005, a planned extension to Edinburgh Airport forced his widow Leslie to move the statue into storage. There he would stay for 6 years, lying his back in a disused car park until 2011, when Mabey made the decision to move Kong to her back garden in Penrith, Cumbria. Finally, Kong would be restored to his former glory and returned to his feet to overlook the Cumbrian countryside. Meanwhile, in 1984, as part of citywide developments, the Birmingham Public Arts Commissions Agency were tasked with producing a statue to sit outside the modern shopping centre. When asked about the potential for Kong to make his triumphant return to Birmingham, David Sparks of the PACA was quoted as saying, "There are a lot of comments about it. Clearly, people relate to King Kong more than they do these modern art creations whose significance is often obscure. I think King Kong was a great loss to Birmingham, and we're seriously going to look at providing some giant-sized animals as a replacement. A bull would perhaps be more appropriate." In 1989, it was suggested that Kong could return to sit on top of the Rotunda building before its proposed demolition. Ultimately, plans changed and the building remains at the centre of Birmingham to this day, minus one fiberglass gorilla.
Bring me sunshine in your smile.
Another of Nicholas Munro's infamous fiberglass creations was a large statue of comedians Eric Morecambe and Ernie Wise. This piece was commissioned by the Arts Council to stand in Battersea Park as part of the British Genius exhibition in 1977, before embarking on a brief tour around the UK. In 2007, the statue was found on a farm in Hungerford, Berkshire, just a few miles from where it had been created in Munro's studio. It was discovered on an exhibition by a team of volunteers from a Morecambe and Wise fan page that had tracked down the statue using nothing more than a black and white image and Google Maps. Although the man himself is now retired, Nicholas Munro's artwork lives on and has become that of legend, cementing the artist's legacy in the hearts and minds of those throughout the UK. In 2016, following Kong's restoration, Leslie Mabey agreed to loan the statue to the Henry Moore Institute in Leeds. There he would stay for 4 months as the star attraction of the 1972 City Sculptures Project exhibition that tracked down and collated all 8 statues from across the UK. Of all the artworks on display, the story of Kong seemed to resonate with people the most. A strange, unloved monster being taken from his home and displayed in a faraway place. Happily, however, this Kong story promises to be much brighter than the tale we already know, as in February 2017 he was reunited with owner Leslie. Birmingham has never truly forgotten about the statue, and his influence is still apparent everywhere from Digbeth to the Jewellery Quarter. There have been many attempts to bring Kong back to Birmingham, which owner Leslie has always been supportive of, despite no one ever actually providing the funds for the visit. For now at least, Kong is back on his hill in Cumbria and remains one of Mabey's most prized possessions, but the legend of Kong will live on forever in Birmingham.